I do hope that we will remember the announcements concerning the upcoming lectureship and that we'll continue to pray for its success. This is an annual effort that's been going on since 1993. God willing, we want to see it turn out profitable in helping people to better understand the Bible and live the Christian life and do those things that are well-pleasing in God's sight. Last week, we spent some time showing that the New Testament church is not a denomination, that the very concept of denominationalism, that each part makes the whole, is foreign to the teaching of the New Testament. We've emphasized time and time again the importance of having biblical authority for all that we believe in practice, Colossians 3:17. And of course, there is no authority for such a concept of the church that Jesus built as there is in denominationalism. But what if you were on this earth and you didn't know any more about salvation than I'm afraid is the case with most of those who believe in God and Christ and the Bible? They don't know how to study it. They don't understand Paul's admonition and teaching to Timothy to study to show himself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth, 2 Timothy 2:15. They don't understand how to ascertain the authority of their Savior, Jesus Christ, from his last will and testament. And in the church, there's too little knowledge concerning how to do that. First of all, if we could just get brethren to read the Bible, we would have gone a long way in helping them grow and to develop and understand what primitive, pure New Testament Christianity actually is. But if you just had your Bible, you would have all you needed to learn how to become a Christian, and to live the Christian life. There is a principle that some people don't know a thing in the world about, even some are in the church, and that is what we call the restoration principle. To restore something is to put it back in its original form. We've all seen that in furniture and so forth. People restored it. But if you lose the Word of God, then if you forget what you knew of it before you lost it, then you're like the people in Hosea to which he spoke, "My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge." Let's suppose that the Lord's church, as you read of it in your New Testament, is not on this earth. But we've seen our Lord tell us that heaven and earth will pass away, but his words would not. So in seed form, the church is always here. It's always to be found in the Word of God when it's handled correctly, 2 Timothy 2:15. Now, whether man believe it or not, that's another story. But the source of salvation is always going to be on this earth. No man or group of men will be able to destroy the Bible from off the face of the earth. There could be times when there are many copies, and there may be times when there are few copies of it. If you go back to the 1500s, there weren't that many copies of the Bible, and many of them were not in the vernacular of the people. Nowadays, we're swamped with about everything anybody can call a Bible, and some that are called Bibles aren't. But nevertheless, they're everywhere. It's sort of like our information age. Information age indeed. We're some of the most ignorant people in the world about anything, and all you have to do is circulate through the population to see it. And that's especially true when it comes to the church that Jesus built and shed his blood to purchase. This is not a new thing, this idea of restoration. If you go back to the Old Testament, you'll read, and I think especially of this one, of good King Josiah. Josiah was 8 years old when he began to reign. And he reigned for many years, about 30 years, something like that. And he did not want to do what was contrary to the will of God, but he didn't know a lot about it. And for a while there, of course, at 8 years old, for a few years, he wasn't able to run his own affairs. But he finally did begin to do what was right, but he was limited in knowing what was right, as the law of Moses taught it for the Jews. But we find when you come over to verse 15 and 16 of chapter 34, the scripture reads, "And Hilkiah answered and said to Shaphan the scribe, I have found the book of the law in the house of the Lord." Now that's a novel place to find the book of the Lord. Imagine finding the book of the Lord where? In a trash heap? Attic somebody's house? In the house of the Lord. I'm quite persuaded among those who call on God as Father and Christ as Savior, who attend churches, even some of them the Lord's church, because of apostasy, the Word of God is lost in the house of the Lord. It's lost in the house of the Lord when we don't recognize its authority, when we won't study it, when we don't learn how to rightly divide it, when we don't spend time with it, when we don't determine to obey it at all cost and to have things done God's way rather than our way. But in verse 16, when they found it, "And Shaphan carried the book to the king and brought the king word back again, saying, all that was committed to thy servants, they do it." Well, if you read on through the chapter, you will find that everything began to be put in order according to the law of Moses. Now they know. Now they have the book. Now they have the word of the Lord. Folks, they're engaged in a restoration effort. See, they didn't know. Now they have the source of knowledge. Now they can begin to do as God required them to do and the way God required them to do it, and so on. Notice as you turn over the latter part of chapter 34, verse 30, "And the king went up into the house of the Lord, and all the men of Judah, and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and the priests, and the Levites, and all the people, great and small. And he read in their ears all the words of the book of the covenant, and they all got mad and left because they couldn't get to the cafeteria fast enough for the Baptist." Oh, that's not in there, is it? It's just in our minds. Can you imagine there the whole of the people standing there and being patient enough to hear that part of the Bible we consider the most hard to read and the most boring read to them? But they did. What does that say about teaching us what the Lord meant when he said, you must hunger and thirst after righteousness before you're going to be filled? Notice the words of the book of the covenant that was found in the house of the Lord. "And the king stood in his place and made a covenant before the Lord to walk after the Lord and to keep his commandments and his testimonies and his statutes with all his heart," no reservations, "and with all his soul to perform the words of the covenant which are written in this book." Brethren, wherever you find an attitude and a man like that and he has the word of God, then today, since we're under the authority of Christ in the New Testament, the church will be there. The same church Jesus built, same church you read about in your own New Testaments when you get around to reading it. "And he caused all that were present in Jerusalem and Benjamin to stand to it. And the inhabitants of Jerusalem did according to the covenant of God, the God of their fathers." And then, of course, it tells you all the efforts of the king to remove all of the pagan stuff. But then as you go through chapter 15, they were able to celebrate the Passover. And here's what is said in verse 18 after they celebrated the Passover, which had not been done. "And there was no Passover like to that kept in Israel from the days of Samuel the prophet. Neither did all the kings of Israel keep such a Passover as Josiah kept, and the priests and the Levites and all Judah and Israel that were present, and the inhabitants of Jerusalem." When people are zealous for God's word, when they're determined to do only as God's word teaches, then the church of our Lord can be restored. That's what it means when we talk about an effort or a movement to restore ancient, pure, primitive New Testament Christianity. is to learn from the Bible and the Bible only that which God has set up. And if Josiah, having found the book of the law in the house of the Lord, could set all of these things in motion according to the authority of the law of Moses for the Jews, and begin to do what they hadn't done as the law had prescribed, then so can I today concerning the teaching of the New Testament in his teaching about God, his Christ, the Holy Spirit, the Bible itself, the right division of the Word, the authority of Jesus Christ, the gospel of Jesus Christ, what it is that God's located all of his power to save us from sin in that gospel, the glad tidings of Christ. For Paul declared, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to every man that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek." Well, that gospel's here. It was commissioned to the apostles and the early church to preach the gospel to every creature because the power to save was there, Mark 16:15. And if you don't hear and understand the gospel, you cannot be saved. Of course, that's with the understanding. When you understand it itself, you're willing to obey it. For God's the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him, Hebrews 5 and verse 8 or 9. Now, with that being said, going back to the very last few years of the 18th century in America, but especially in the early 19th century, there was a group of people, many of them unknown to one another, in the colonies, then what was the frontier time, and in that time the frontiers of the United States would be Kentucky, and that would be way out in the frontier. But they knew they had the Bible. They knew the Bible was the Word of God. And no problem saying that. They all agreed on it. But there was Presbyterians, and there were Methodists, and there were Baptists, and so on. Each one having its own particular creed that said, you got to believe this or you can't be that. And one can't go to the other. People don't know what denominationalism really is today, because everybody just pretty well says, well, God's my Father, I sin, I don't know whatever that is, but it separates me from God, whatever that means. Jesus is my Savior, can't save myself. Jesus, will you save me? Yes, he saved me, and everything else you do, and just say Jesus, and it sanctifies it. To a great extent, that's what people think of, and every denomination pretty much believes that. In those days, each denomination thought they were right and the others were wrong. They thought that because they thought their Bible taught what they believed and condemned what the other didn't or did believe. And if you would study history and read about it, you'd find out there were these group of men I mentioned earlier who said, if we all have the same Bible and we all worship the same God and we all have the same Savior, why are we divided when we can read even ourselves the Lord's Prayer for unity? That we may be one, even as God and the Father are one. And for the specific reason that the world may believe that God sent the Christ. But when there's this division like exists in denominationalism, that can't be. There was also the rebuke of Paul because, you know, they read their Bibles in those days. There might not be another book in the house, but there was a Bible. They learned to read from it. And they read it daily, for they didn't have much else to read in those days of log cabins and dirt floors and candles and such like, a very hard life. And they read where Paul rebuked the church in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 10 because they were divided. He said, you ought to be of the same mind and the same judgment. There'd be no divisions among you. And they looked around them. They were ordinary, common sense people. And here are all these people saying, we worship God. We have the same Bible. Christ is our Savior, but we're all divided. So the first thing they began to do was say, what is separating us? It didn't take long for them to figure that out. It was the creeds and the prayer books and the catechisms and the councils and the synods and the conferences of men. That's what was separating them and making this church and that church. And in those days, you didn't just switch denominations like many, many people do today. you couldn't just be in the Baptist church and go over to the Presbyterian church because you had more friends over there, and that was all right. You had to make it very clear that you disagreed now with what you left and that you agreed with this is right. And there were those men who thought, why must we be this way? Well, let me ask you something. Is that a bad thing? When you read the prayer of Christ for unity, and you read Paul, inspired of the Holy Spirit, writing part of the New Testament, rebuking the church at Corinth, and saying there ought not be these divisions among you. You ought to be of the same mind and the same judgment. Is that characteristic of sectarian denominationalism? Of course not. It wasn't then, it's not today, it wasn't before then, and it never will be. But that's what men have come to accept as the definition of Christianity. You know why? Because they don't study their Bible like those folks then did. In this great information age, you realize how much you can find in a matter of 30 minutes in doing research on your computer, on the internet? In my writing and in my research, I find more within an hour than years ago I could find in sometimes days. Because right there at your fingertips. And yet we're probably more ignorant of the Bible than we ever have been in the history of the United States. Now these men that started this in the late 18th century and early 19th century, they weren't the only ones that had done that. They had roots back over in Europe, especially in England and even more especially in Scotland. But those roots went further back, all the way back to the beginning of the so-called Protestant Reformation as they protested corruption in the Catholic Church in the 1500s. In the area known as the Czech Republic and the country of Slovakia, it used to all be Czechoslovakia, there was a man by the name of Ulrich Zwingli. He even debated Martin Luther. But Martin Luther's view of the Bible held sway over most of the Protestant Reformation. Zwingli's didn't. In fact, he was later killed in a battle. But guess what Zwingli taught and challenged Martin Luther on it? Zwingli says if it is not authorized by the New Testament, it is wrong. Luther taught if it's not expressly forbidden by the New Testament, we can do it. And that's what governs denominationalism today. So these roots are going back to the Bible and the Bible only as the infallible, the inerrant, the all-sufficient, final and complete, as I say, final, complete revelation of God to man, 2 Timothy 3:16, 17, James 1:25, where men speak as the oracles of God, which God tells us to do. He doesn't say if you want to, you can, but if you don't want to, you don't have to. He says, if any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. The only way to do that is to know the oracles of God, and the only place you can find them is in the Bible. So men realize that. Why are we divided? Well, you've got to remember, they're in a new situation and place in America. They're not bound by the shackles of tradition and culture that was throughout Europe. And they feel pretty well free to do as they please when it came to determining what was right and wrong in God's sight. If we just realize the attitude of the average American in the first 50 years of the 19th century, we'd see it has changed drastically since those days. In those days, their attitude was, we're free and independent to pursue life, liberty, and happiness. You ever heard that? In a certain document that begins, we hold these truths to be self-evident. I'm not preaching Americanism. I'm preaching what set those men free to think as they had never thought before and to carry what started in Europe to its fruition. They had a new constitution for these United States. But more than that, they had found the Constitution of God among the very people who claimed to worship him, but they didn't know it. And because they didn't know it, they did not recognize the restoration of pure primitive New Testament Christianity and the Church of the Living God produced thereby. And listen, it's the only way it's produced. Consider the seed principle. That figured into this whole thing. We've been studying in Genesis, and we learned that everything produces after its kind. And it speaks of seeds, and we know what seeds are. You plant a black-eyed pea, you don't get a watermelon. You plant a pecan, which is a seed, by the way, you know. And if the germ of life's in it, it's going to produce a pecan tree. Peach tree, peach seeds just produce peach trees. And you know, in the king of Tutankhamun, in the tomb of King Tutankhamun, discovered in, I think, 1923, some 5,000 years old, they found wheat seed. 5,000 years old. That's a very dry climate over there, and it preserves things. They planted some of it. Oak trees sprouted from it. What would you say if I told you that? No, that wheat seed germinated, and it came up, and it was a wheat plant. That's what you expect, wouldn't you? But 5,000 years separated it from the time it was put into that tomb to the time that they planted it and set the germination life process in motion that God ordained back in the beginning. Jesus comes along and tells us plainly in Luke 8 verse 11 that the seed of the kingdom is the word of God. Jesus tells us that kingdom refers to the same institution of the same institution of the saved as the church does, as the body of Christ is, as the house of God is, as the temple of God is, as it's used in the New Testament to refer to the realm of the saved. And when he said, I will build my church, he said to Peter, I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom. Talking about the same institution. By understanding those different terms, we understand the different things God wants us to about the nature of the kingdom. Well, that seed, King Tutankhamun's tomb, brought forth what it was, wheat. When you find the seed of the kingdom, the Bible in general and the New Testament in particular, and you preach the pure ancient gospel of Jesus Christ, men honestly and in love with God, His Christ, and the truth of Christ found only in the Word of Christ. They believe it, for faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God, Romans 10:17, and from no other source. And they know that but without faith it's impossible to please Him, for he that cometh to God must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek after Him. Hebrews 11:6. And they continue to read the seed of the kingdom that Jesus said is the source of bringing forth the kingdom. When it's sown in the heart, the minds of men, and men being free moral agents, pay attention to it. Understand it. You see, they can do that in any other thing. We go to school, we learn. Maybe you learn how to be an architect. Maybe you read a blueprint. And if you follow that blueprint, though it may be 1,000 years old, if you follow that blueprint and you build according to that blueprint, you don't deviate from the authority in that blueprint, you will have the structure that the blueprint was designed to produce. Do we or do we not have the seed of the kingdom in our hands this day? Yes, we do. Luke 8:11. And when it is taught to men, verse 15, who have honest and good hearts, it'll bring forth fruit abundantly. So it doesn't make any difference about whether you know personally of the church of our Lord on earth, that is, members of it, or whether you don't. You do or you don't. If you will take into your mind the pure, simple, powerful gospel of Jesus Christ, the seed of the kingdom, which is the Word of God, the power of God to save you from sin by believing it and from the heart obeying it. By after believing, repenting of your sins, which you're commanded to do, Acts 17:30. One time God winked at this ignorance, but now commandeth all men, nobody left out, everywhere, to repent. And then as you study that seed of the kingdom, following the source of faith and the command to repent, lo and behold, you learn that one is to confess with the mouth that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, Romans 10:10, Matthew 10:32. All of those are steps leading you toward becoming a Christian. Not some hyphenated Christian, some kind of a Christian. You can't find that in your New Testament. It's not in the seed of the kingdom, the Word of God. Just a Christian. That means of Christ. Nothing more. Nothing less. Nothing else. A Christian, a member of the church Jesus built and purchased with His blood, Acts 20 and verse 28. Then you'll learn in the Great Commission, in Mark's account, that he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. You'll see the first time the gospel in its fullness was preached in Acts 2 on that first Pentecost following the establishment or the death of Christ, that the church was established. And men and brethren, people cried out, as believers, they had believed the message that proved Christ was the Messiah, the Son of God. What shall we do? Well, that's contrary to everything denominationalism teaches for the most part. They say believe and believe only, and that's all that's necessary. They didn't understand that way. They were believers. They interrupted the sermon. Men and brethren, what shall we do? And Peter took them as believers and said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. Do you believe that? You sort of sometimes, with people who've had the Bible for a long time, feel like Paul before Agrippa saying, I know that thou believest. When he asked him if he believed the prophets, I know that thou believest. Well then, what hinders a person from doing what they know they believe? All sorts of prejudices can do that. All kinds of pride can do that. But the seed of the kingdom, which is the Word of God, when fully understood, teaches a plan of salvation. The Word of God creates faith, and on that faith, one continues his road to salvation. Repenting of sins, confessing one's faith in Christ, being immersed in water by the authority of Christ to obtain the remission of sins. Now that's all there is to it to become a Christian, such as you read about in your New Testament. The Lord will add you to His church, Acts 2 and verse 47. That's what He did with those people who were baptized for the remission of sins on the day the church started. There was only one church to which He added them. And you know why? There are as many churches acceptable to God Almighty, the Father, as there are sons of God acceptable to Him. Now, how many sons of God are acceptable to Him? Far as I know, He had only one. He had only one. Now, the situation is, do we believe what the Bible says in that matter? And do we believe it enough to act upon it? Well, these people back in the day, which we're going to develop further as God allows, they read these things just like you can read them, just like I can read them. If you'd never heard of me or anybody like me preaching what I preach, you know it was there in your Bible all along. And you can check me up on it and say, did he preach what's in the Bible? Is the seed principle true? Is the restoration principle true? Were those things written aforetime in the Old Testament, written for our learning? That we through patience and comfort of those Old Testament scriptures might have hope, Romans 15:4. Paul said they were. Now what I learned from Josiah? I learned you give me the book of the law, which is sometimes lost in the house of God, and I can have what God intended. You give me a New Testament of Jesus Christ and an honest-hearted person who will study it like God said, with the intent to obey God when they learn His will. And when they obey the truth, they'll be Christians. I don't care whether they're in China California or some other foreign place. I don't care where it would be. They'll become Christians. Nothing more, nothing less, nothing else. Members of the church Jesus built on the way to heaven as long as they remain faithful to the teachings of the New Testament regarding living the Christian life. Brethren, do you see how simple that is? That was fresh to those people in the late 18th and especially early 19th centuries. And they came out by droves from denominationalism, which they now knew was foreign to the New Testament. And they embraced simple, pure, primitive New Testament Christianity and called for other people to do the same thing. The Lord's church itself even lost sight of what I've been preaching this morning. And you can go into great many places and never hear what... I'm talking about churches of Christ and never hear what I've just preached. That's sad. But it's happened, as is oftentimes, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. After all, it's kind of good to be like the people round about us. Feel comfortable with them. Get along with them. But when you decide to take a stand for the truth and live as close to Jesus Christ and His teaching as you can, you may find that, as Paul told Timothy, all who live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. I challenge you to do as best you can to live as close to the New Testament as possible, because Jesus said, "He that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words hath one that judgeth him. The words that I have spoken shall judge him in the last day," John 12:48. It's not what the preacher thinks. It's not what the catechism teaches. It's not what a certain church teaches. It's what Jesus Christ and His last will and testament teaches that will get you to heaven. You spurn it, there's no hope. We've learned what to do to become a Christian. As a child of God, there's a second law of pardon if you sin, to repent of your sins, confess those sins, and pray God for forgiveness. Whatever your situation today, then we humbly ask you to think about these things as we stand and sing.